half in the bag.
I stood on my scale yesterday and it said one at a time, please.
Oh, it's so cold in here.
It's fucking freezing.
I wish we could see our own breath. It's so cold, our breath doesn't show.
It's too cold to even...
No, it's a scientific thing. It becomes invisible.
Whatever. Oh, it's fucking cold.
Oh, what's this? Hey, they're not opened.
Oh, great.
Yeah, we're not really in a rush anymore.
Yeah.
Got these. Well, we just watched a film recently, The Hateful Eight, about a group of people in the freezing cold who are miserable and kill each other.
Mm-hmm.
Let's watch another movie with the same plot line.
Out here in the wild, when you don't fit in, life can be a real bear. Especially for Nor.
What good is a bear if he can't even hunt, huh?
Why didn't you take a picture? It'll last longer.
No. The Revenant is the new Alejandro Iñárritu film. He's the guy who made last year's best picture film, Birdman. In this new movie, Leonardo DiCaprio plays Hugh Glass, an 1820s era fur trapper who gets raped by a bear, buried alive, and then vows revenge on Shinzon, who is played by Tom Hardy. This film is the latest entry into the human misery genre. So grab a date, get your popcorn, and settle in to watch a horse get disemboweled. Well, Jay, what did you think of The Revenant? And if you don't know what the word revenant means, I didn't know either. I looked it up on the internet. It means someone who comes back or comes back from the dead.
Yes. Well, we just saw it very recently, and I'm not sure how I feel about it. I'm trying to process it because it's a great movie. It's incredibly well made. It's very impressive, as we discovered, and I think one of the big things people are talking about, it's all natural light. There's only a couple hours out of the day they could shoot it. All the technical aspects of the movie are great. I'm not sure what I was supposed to get out of it, though. Other than, look at how great we are at making movies.
Well, Jay, I'd like to say this film was a technical wonderment. The craft of filmmaking is alive and well with Alejandro Iñárritu. The wonderful composition, the long takes, the shot with all available light. They filmed this in, I want to say it was like South Dakota and Montana or something, and they filmed in like sub-zero temperatures, and it was like they had 90 minutes a day to shoot because they shot at a certain time of day where the light was perfect. And then it's one of those things where that's the selling point of the movie. And
it's the new Boyhood.
It's the new Boyhood.
It took 12 years to make. They shot in bad temperatures.
Shot negative 12 degrees.
Yeah.
While it was technically flawless, I think you and I both felt the same way. That was a little like, what exactly are we supposed to get from this?
Yeah.
You know, I was intrigued by this movie because it's like based on true events. And it was funny because in the trailers before this movie, they have a preview for The Conjuring 2.
Also based on true events.
Based on the secret case files of Ed and Lorraine Warren. And I know all about Ed and Lorraine Warren. The most thing that ever happened to them was like a table moved an inch.
In the name of Jesus Christ, I command you to reveal your identity.
And this is like insane shit going on the screen. Nothing's based, whenever it says based on, we've had this discussion before, whenever it says based on a true story, I want to puke all over it. And so I'm watching, I had no idea what this was about. Like, and I was like, oh, it's a true story. This guy, this bear attack, and he's left for dead by his, you know. The main character, Hugh Glass,
Huge Ass? His name is Huge Ass?
No. Huge Ass, Hugh Glass, was indeed a frontiersman.
Okay.
That's all they know about him.
Oh, so that's where the true story ends?
They discovered he wrote some letters, so he was literate. He was a frontiersman guy who went around and got pelts, and he got attacked by a bear. There was a mother bear and two cubs, and he's like, ah, fuck! And then his friends came and shot the bear.
This is the real story.
This is the real story. And then he's like, oh, fuck. And then they what happened is true. The two guys stayed behind. The rest of them went ahead. And they're like, you know, they're getting further and further ahead of us. He looks like he's dead. They'll put him in the dirt. And then, and that's where the real story kind of ends and legend begins.
Okay.
And so it's like, he crawled 80 miles to get them. And then he crawled 100 miles, and he crawled 500 miles. And then it becomes like a tall tale almost.
Sure.
And he did not have a Native American wife as far as they know. He did not have a son. Like, all that was dramatized. And same with, like, the showdown at the end and all that stuff. Basic premise is true. It took place on planet Earth. And there was a guy who was mauled by a bear, left for dead, and crawled out and said, I'm not dead.
Mm.
There's some other stuff going on. There's a group of Native Americans, and there's one like tribal chief guy who's looking for his daughter, who's been kidnapped by rapey Frenchmen. And, you know, it's like, and then...
All these elements that feel like they were put in the movie, so it's not 2 hours of Leonardo DiCaprio wandering around in the woods. Yeah, which, well, it's close to anyway.
But Inarritu said, I think somewhere in an interview, like, he wanted to make a movie about what drives someone to fight, to live. And I guess it's to get revenge on a guy who stabbed your son.
There's a line towards the end of the movie, I guess minor spoilers, but he, you know, he trudges through the woods after being mauled by a bear, all this shit happens to him, and then he finally gets back. And he says, the main thing keeping me alive was getting my revenge on Tom Hardy. And at no point during anything with him in the woods or trying to survive did I get any idea that that was his motivation. I always thought his motivation was just not dying. I at no point was I thinking, like, he is pulling to survive simply so he can get revenge on Tom Hardy.
I disagree slightly. I mean, I wasn't filled with this overwhelming, like, rage or whatever, but that, something like that is hard to translate on screen, like, other than him looking mad. It's interior emotions. So they do have one part where he writes on the ice with a rock. He goes, Fitzgerald killed my son,
yeah.
You know? And then there's always like kind of dream sequences where he's dreaming about his son or his wife. And it kind of reminded me of Gladiator a little. That's kind of simplistic story where there's a guy and he's fucked and they burned his village and killed his wife. He's nothing to live for except to get the bastard who did it.
Yes.
So it's weird because it has that mesh of that kind of Hollywoodish plot line with this really like innovative, interesting film. That
trying to do something sort of gritty and realistic, grounded in reality, but then you have these schmaltzy, I'm dreaming of my dead wife moments.
Yeah. And the showdown with the bad guy. Like, spoilers. You know, and performance-wise, everyone is great in the movie except for Leo.
Tom Hardy is awesome in this movie.
Tom Hardy, he deserves the supporting actor.
Well, Leo is nominated. Leo is Leo in this movie.
Leo is one of those actors that you can understand everything from his eyes, because there's a very few words that he deliver. He has to make you feel very many complex emotions simultaneously with his body language and only with his eyes.
The big praise that they're saying is like all the tough situations he was in. He really eats a fish or whatever. Like,
so what?
There's a difference between a good acting performance and a performance that's physically demanding. Like, it's impressive what he does in this movie physically, but his face is always just,
Wrestling is physically demanding, but you don't see those guys getting Oscars. I'm looking at you, Hulk Hogan.
Hulk Hogan got an Oscar for Suburban Commando, don't you remember?
Oh shit, that's right. That joke doesn't work.
How do you know which ones are the right ones?
You have to squeeze it a bit.
Wow, I found a good one.
There's something about Leo where it's like the wool is over everyone's eyes, where they think he's this great actor, but in this movie, like, he just kind of grunts, and then he does that stupid voice. Leo cannot do an accent.
Yes.
I don't do the southern voice. I'm Leo DiCaprio, and this is probably what fur traders sounded like, right? In the 1820s, I'm gonna sound like I'm a Hollywood actor in a movie who's playing a fur trader.
As far as I can tell, my place is right here on the smart end of this rifle.
And Tom Hardy, he becomes that character. Leo, yeah. It looks like an actor playing that role. Tom Hardy just, is that Tom Hardy? You know, yeah. You're like, what?
Mm-hmm. After 6 months working my ass off like a mule, risking my neck, men dying for what?
Same with all the other actors.
And everyone else. I mean, Dom Nahal Lee-san, he's fine, you know, everyone's fine. Tom Hardy stands out. He's really good. It reminded me a whole lot of Black Swan and my other favorite actor, Natalie Portman. And Black Swan, of course, an awesome film, but she just makes a face like she's constipated the whole movie. There's no acting in that. Everyone else is good. What's her face from the 70s show?
Mila Kunis.
Everyone's good in that movie. And then Natalie Portman, Natalie Portman's brilliant.
Yeah.
Because she's in Black Swan.
It's the situation surrounding
it. It's the situation and the film surrounding the lead.
Yeah.
And the other stars shine through brighter, I think, than Leo and Natalie did in that. Speaking of Natalie Portman, we saw a trailer for...
Jane Got a Gun.
Yeah. I predict great things for that film. I predict this 16% on Rotten Tomatoes. That's my prediction, 16% on Rotten Tomatoes.
Mark it down. We'll see how accurate it is.
Write it down in your journals or notebooks, kids.
But yeah, like Natalie Portman, that seems to be the case with this movie, but even more so with this movie, everyone's just talking about how physically demanding it is. Which, you know, props to Leo for that, I guess, but there are certain elements of that kind of took me out of the movie too, because I know Leonardo DiCaprio is vegetarian in real life, maybe even vegan, and there's a part in the movie when he hasn't eaten for days and he stumbles across this Native American man that's got a buffalo that's, you know, he's killed and is eating, and Leo wants some, and he gives him like a liver or something, and I read that was a real organ, whatever it is. And he takes a bite in it, and he's like, and he gags and spits it out, which is, I'm assuming they kept in the movie because it's real, because it feels real. But in the context of this character, in this environment, back in those days, that would not be something that would physically repulse him. If we're given Academy Awards for people that are doing dangerous or gross things, then Johnny Knoxville and the Jackass guys should have plenty of awards by now. Wow. They drank horse semen.
Yeah. How about Knox? Piss that out.
I don't really like the expression all style, no substance, but that kind of applies to this.
Yeah.
A technical marvel, but not much else going on. Like, there's no sort of deeper thematic elements that really stood out to me.
Yeah.
And
there were some kind of like hints and little notes of religion in there, and you know, choosing the right path of not taking revenge. Because in real life, the guy did not get revenge.
Okay.
He forgave them for burying him alive.
Ah.
As I think any sound person would. I related a lot with Tom Hardy's character. I would not have stabbed.
How much of that is because of the performance, though?
He obviously lived a miserable life.
Sure.
And Dom Nahal Gleason says, you know, is it really worth the pelts? Like, we got to get going.
Yeah.
Is your life worth the pelts? He's like, yeah, I need money.
Yeah.
Or else I have nothing. And I was like, oh, that's kind of miserable.
I'm trying to tell you, you're going to lose these pelts.
You'd rather hold on to the pelts of your life.
Life? What life are you talking about? I ain't got no life. I just got living. The only way I get to do that is through these pelts.
Yeah, and then, he got partially scalped.
Yeah.
At one point, not in his past, not in the movie, but he has like a scar, missing hair. And you can just tell he's lived a miserable fucking life. And he's tough. And he doesn't give a shit about anyone but himself. And you kind of have to survive in that kind of environment. And he's just like, and they're carrying around this guy who's been mauled by a fucking bear. And who, and under any reasonable person's logic, probably would have died in 24 hours.
Sure.
He didn't know he was gonna live, and he's just like, fuck this, you know?
Yeah.
And I'm like, okay.
He's a little deceptive about way he goes about doing things.
He does a pretty evil trick where he tells him to blink if he wants him to kill him. And,
yeah.
And Leo's trying to hold his eyes open. And
yeah.
He's like, oh, you finally blinked. Okay, you want me choking? I'm like, okay, I would have done that. Like, I gotta get the fuck out of there.
Yeah. I was thinking about that during the scene when they're still trying, the whole group is still together, and they're trying to carry him up that really steep mountain.
Yes.
I was like, fuck that.
Yeah. This movie had hints of Dances with Wolves a little, like the white man who spoke the language and then romanced the Native American lady, and then and Kevin Costner also ate a liver.
Oh,
because the Native American guy, can we just say Indian? The Indian guy cut open a bison and pulled out something. He's like, and then Kevin Costner's like, I gotta fit in.
Yeah,
I gotta prove I'm not just some cracker. And then he eats it. But I'm assuming for Kevin Costner, it was just a big thing of Jell-O. Kevin Costner's like, fuck, I'm not even eating a raw liver. What are you, nuts? What do you think, I want an Oscar? I'll get one anyway for this. And he did.
Yeah. Note to Leo, you don't need to eat a real liver to get an Oscar.
Right. It's about your acting.
Yeah. But not in this case, he has to make up for his acting.
Yeah.
Knows how far I came for.
I think what it is with Leo is there's that scene in Django Unchained that everyone talks about endlessly, about how he accidentally cut his hand while shooting, so he's bleeding everywhere. And he's like, oh, you like that? And then this whole movie is just him cutting himself.
Yeah.
This is the equivalent of like a teenage girl. He's just a cutter. Love me. Give me a goddamn Oscar already.
Maybe. Well, the bear, I have to ask if the bear was CG, I'm assuming, because
that was CG.
The motions, but it looked really good.
It's one of those things where it is CG. To me, it was obvious it was CG. It's very good looking CG.
What's the term where no matter how good looking a human face is, you can always recognize them?
The uncanny valley, and that's the effect I was getting with this, where it's like, clearly Alejandro Iñárritu? Clearly has the idea in his mind of how he wants to execute the scene, lots of long takes. I think that whole bear attack is one shot, maybe two or three shots, but just lots of long shots. And I think the only way you could orchestrate something like that is with a CG bear, because obviously you can't get a real bear to do that much.
You don't want to fuck around with a real bear like that.
You
have to walk up and go,
yeah, there's very specific, like you could shoot this more traditionally where you get cutaways of the bear and then a bear puppet in the foreground as it attacks Leo. So he had this way he wanted to do it, but it's just the entire time you're watching it, there's that part of your brain that knows it's not real.
Yeah. But still, I mean, my brain went there. I'm like, I'm just gonna enjoy this.
Yeah.
And I kind of shut it off. I'm like, stop.
I couldn't. Same with the buffalo later on. There's that herd of buffalo. That all looks CG to me.
Yeah. I think that's us though. Like,
maybe a normal audience goer maybe wouldn't key in on that so much.
But the bear looked really good for being close up and all that stuff.
It's very, very good CG. It's just, it sticks out when everything else feels so real.
And there was a rumor that the bear rapes him, because the bear, there's lots of shots where he's facing camera and the bear's behind him going like this, and it's kind of like pouncing on him.
Yeah.
So somebody thought he was being raped by the bear, which was not true. Most likely a female bear protecting her cubs.
Sure.
The male bear just leaves, and then the female bear goes around with the cubs. And then if you fuck with the cubs, you better watch out for mama bear. That's why they have the expression, look out for mama bear. So she gave Leo a thrashing.
Yeah.
But Leo was not raped by a bear. The only male to animal like intercourse was when Leo got all up in that horse.
Yes, he gets deep inside a horse.
So you gotta watch the movie to see Leo get naked and put himself inside of a horse. I was just sitting there waiting for Leo to say, and I thought they smelled bad on the outside. Jay, can we also talk about how Leo's character was a Mary Sue? I mean, he was good at everything. Like, he just, he knew how to speak all the languages, he knew all the routes, he knew how to heal himself, he knew how to cauterize his own wounds.
Yeah.
And Jesus Christ.
Can we also talk about how nobody had ever used the expression Mary Sue until somebody posted it on Twitter once?
Get to the boat! To the boat, sir!
It was epic, it was brutal, it was gruesome. It was violent, it was heartbreaking, it was painful, and all the things I love in movies. And for some reason, I liked it.
I liked it a lot. Admired it more than I liked it.
There were some scenes that were really good, and I when I heard people were saying it was boring, I was so excited to see it then. That means that I will probably enjoy it. I liked slow-paced stuff, and this certainly was.
Sure.
And it had its sprinkling of horrific violence, you know, to keep you your appetite satisfied throughout the film. But in the end, emotionally, I wasn't too invested.
Right.
Like, I felt bad what happened to his son and his wife, but I wasn't feeling that a super strong urge for revenge, which may have been a good thing because, like I said, I sort of understood Tom Hardy's character a little bit. He was a dick.
Yeah.
But he wasn't the mustache-twirling villain who, I'm just gonna be an asshole for no reason.
Yeah, well, and like what he says at one point is, he's like, it doesn't matter what happened to me, it's not gonna bring your son back.
Yeah.
And that's, I mean, I guess that's ultimately the point of the movie. I just don't know if the journey there was worth such a simple little idea that we've seen before, for one thing, just not executed this particular way. I just don't know if that justifies the movie, if that makes sense.
Yeah, it's well put.
I ain't afraid to die anymore. I've done it already.
Jay, would you recommend Revenants?
I would, just to marvel at the filmmaking. I'd recommend seeing it in the theater.
It's
a good movie to see
on
a big screen.
What did the one lady say after we got out of the
movie? Any movie you see now that's over 2 hours long, someone will say this in the lobby. Someone said the same thing they said after Hateful Eight, which is, that's 2.5 hours of my life I'll never get back. When really, and it's always elderly people. Like, what the fuck else are they gonna do?
You should
be thankful that you're around for 2.5 more hours.
We should have said, hey bitch, when do you ever get any time of your life back?
That's true, that's very
who
true.
Who are you, Doc Brown? Shut the fuck up. You live in Wisconsin and it's the winter. What are you gonna do?
Yeah.
Sit around with your foam cheese head on?
Just waiting for next Packers season?
Eating cheese? You just watched a movie that a whole bunch of people put a whole lot of effort into making. And you paid $5 for it with your senior discount. you old cantankerous I hope your car hits a brick wall. You would recommend The Revenant
for
elderly women to marvel at the filmmaking.
Yeah.
Elderly women, they have no fucking idea how hard it was to make that. They just go, oh, it's in the woods.
I guess, I would also recommend this movie if you want something to complain about.
Yeah, there you go.
Just complain about everything. All this hard work, all this marvelous filmmaking, but whatever. It was boring.
I would recommend Revenant, I guess. if you have a low attention span, no. And if you're offended or shocked by like horrific violence, it's a gruesome tough movie. It's rough and it's miserable.
These are all things I like in a movie, but it just, for whatever reason, it didn't quite click. Something just felt a little empty in it. But it's a valiant effort.
It's a spectacle.
Yeah.
It's a sight to be seen.
Sure.
And it's worth checking out.
Norm of the North.
Dinner is served.
So the Oscars are coming up. Are you also looking forward to the Super Bowl, though?
I am. Well, not anymore. I was, but now the Green Bay Packers are no longer going to be in the Super Bowl.
Why aren't the Green Bay Packers playing the Super Bowl?
They didn't play football. Right,
oh now. My God! I've been raped by a bear! And also, I'm white.